generation of today has no clue about the truthful accounts of world history. And in the United Kingdom, school libraries are robbing their children of the vital facts of the past. Books like Mosheim's Ecclesiastical History by John Lawrence Mosheim are hard to trace. Rank's History of the Popes should be in people's private collection. Walter Walsh was a brilliant British historian who documented from authentic, credible sources when describing British history. Jean-Henri Merle d'Aubigné was a Swiss-French historian whose brilliant work on the Reformation should be in people's personal private collection also. James Aitken Wiley, the Scottish historian, is the best of the best, and his works are an absolute treasure. If you do not have a background of European history, especially the works of these 19th century intellectuals, then you will never understand the mechanisms of the world today. An ex-Franciscan monk, Joseph McCabe, who became the papacy's fiercest critic, wrote a book in 1937 that was rewritten in 1951 titled The Papacy in Politics Today. And he gave a much more in-depth account than the weak historians we have today. He said that in the fateful year 1939, Cardinal Pacelli was elected Pope Pius XII. As a reward, Cardinal Hinsey says, for his 10 years superb fight for peace. He had allied the Vatican with Germany, Italy, and Japan, helped Franco to seize Spain, and delivered the peoples of South America to the tender mercies of fascist colonels and generals of the Peron type. His moral authority was mortgaged. On the very day of his coronation, March the 12th, Mussolini drove 69,000 Jews, beggared and suffering, from Italy. But the Pope was too busy to notice the outrage. His church, it is said, saved many Jews. Yes, rich, converted Jews. The policy of the heads of the Roman Church is stamped in red letters on the history of Europe. Unfortunately, no branch of public instruction in school, press, or literature in our time is so lamentably distorted by suppressions and untruths as are references to the part that the Church has played in European history. The candor of the fine historians of the last century has disappeared with them. We now get histories of Europe which completely falsify the role of the Church, and our more important historians are silent. Does it matter if we leave the dead past to mold on its grave? It does, vitally, when the claims which are made for the value of the Church today are based mainly upon the apologist's version of history. It matters still more from our present point of view, because now that people know nothing about the Church's crimes against humanity in the past, they are less inclined than ever to consider critically its action in our modern world. What secular journalists, historians, heads of state and politicians fail to say is that her diplomacy has also cost the lives of millions of souls all over the world. The late Eugenio Pacelli was a shrewd and ruthless, bespectacled diplomat, a member of the Italian black nobility. He signed a concordat in 1914 with Serbia that provoked the conflict in the Balkans that led to the First World War. He signed a concordat with the Nazis in 1933 that led to the Second World War. He later became Pope Pius XII. You will scarcely see a book written on the papacy's role in the two world wars, neither a video, DVD or documentary on TV. The secular world is just too scared. When you look at the heads of state, Ante Pavelic, the Poglavnic, the head of Croatia, you can see him with the papal hierarchy with the fascist salute. Benito Mussolini, the Il Duce, the head of fascist Italy, also with the papal hierarchy doing the fascist salute. Francisco Franco, the Generalissimo, the head of fascist Spain, also with the papal hierarchy doing the fascist salute. And Adolf Hitler, the Führer, the Austrian-born German dictator, with the papal hierarchy with the fascist salute. This was the biggest attempt ever to take over the entire planet. But secular historians sidestep and deliberately bypass the role of Eugenio Pacelli and the papacy and their support for fascism. In the British newspaper, The Voice, it documents the high volume of black troops and black individuals who were mercilessly murdered by the Nazis during the Second World War. The French incorporated many men from its former colonies to occupy the Rhineland in Germany after the First World War. The Nazis put this propaganda poster out during the war to show the inferiority of France's army, Frank Reed's Schuld, or France's responsibility. And a German engraver did coins that flamed racial hostility during the war when African soldiers occupied Germany. But who was the instigator behind that racial hostility? The English Catholic historian John Cornwell has attempted to backtrack what he has said about Pacelli, but it is too late. For in his book titled Hitler's Pope, with access to the Vatican secret archives, he documents that Eugenio Pacelli and the papal hierarchy were the biggest instigators of that lie that German women were being raped by black soldiers. He said that as early as April 1920, responding to a request of German bishops and lay petitioners, Pacelli had informed Gaspari that France's black troops were routinely raping German women and children in the Rhineland, and that the influence of the Holy See should be employed to bring pressure on the French government to remove these soldiers forthwith. In a reply to Gaspari on January the 16th, the French ambassador to the Holy See vigorously dismissed Pacelli's and Bertram's allegations, describing them as odious propaganda inspired by Berlin. During the pontificate of Joseph Ratzinger, aka Pope Benedict XVI, many questioned if he collaborated with the Nazis when a youth. But many, especially in the Jewish community, were angry when he endorsed a bishop who had Nazi sympathies. But people still just can't see. 2014 and also 2013 has seen quite a number of World War II films, but historians are either ignorant of the papacy's role, or if they do get access to material, they won't use it for fear of not getting funding by high-profile studios. Kostra Gavras, the Greek-French filmmaker and the current president of the Cinématique Française, made a film titled Amen, showing the papacy's role in the Second World War, for he is renowned for covering controversial political issues. Most people tiptoe around this issue, but this director braved it up to a point. The British newspaper, The Daily Mail, did an interesting review on the film that has some interesting points. The veteran director, Kostra Gavras, grapples with an issue that Hollywood has been wary to approach. Kostra Gavras never mentions Pastor Troll's personal reputation for anti-Semitism or his dislike for black people. One of the main protagonists in the film is a young Jesuit priest. The Jesuits, the shock troops of Rome, have a clever way of covering their bloodthirsty history, not being detected for their past global horrors. But not everyone is buying into it. In a book titled Unholy War, The Vatican's Role in the Rise of Modern Anti-Semitism, Jewish writer David I. Kurtzer said that Roberto Fanicani, a member of the Fascist Grand Council, spoke on the Church and the Jews at Milan's Institute for Fascist Culture. Farinacci recalled that the constitution of the Jesuit order forbade it from accepting as members anyone descended from the Jewish race up to the fifth generation, and added, "The Aryan racism of the Jesuits is thus more severe than that of Germany itself." The fascists thus had in the Jesuits constant precursors and masters in the Jewish question, and if we can be faulted for anything, it is for not having applied all of their intransigence in our dealings with the Jews. The seeds of Catholic anti-Semitism in Austria that had been planted with the Vatican's help in the last two decades of the 19th century continued to bear fruit in the years following the First World War. A widely distributed lecture by a well-known Jesuit orator, Victor Kolb, reflects the tenor of Austrian Catholic attitudes toward the Jews as the war began. Kolb's speech was immediately translated into Italian and printed at the request of Father Radomir Ledochowski, the Polish priest soon to become head of the Jesuit order worldwide. He had copies of the speech distributed throughout the Vatican. The Polish priest Wladimir Ledochowski, who became the superior general or head of the Jesuits, sometimes called the Black Pope, was the biggest instigator of fueling racial discontent in Vatican circles. He could definitely pass as Count Dracula, he just looks very dark. But he was a very good friend with another Pole, Count Wladimir Zamoyski, a Polish nobleman who owned large tracts of land. Zamoyski was the guardian to another Pole, one of the most influential but least known figures of the 20th century, Joseph Hieronym Rettinger. Joseph Rettinger was a Catholic Polish political advisor who advised the Polish government during the Second World War that included his close friend, the Prime Minister of Poland, General Ladislaw Sikorski. It was his high contacts with high-ranking papal dignitaries that included Cardinal Cento that Rettinger was able to get access into nearly every political circle that also included the President of the United States. He was the most influential figure that shaped the policy of post-war Europe that included the Council of Europe. But this Roman Catholic socialist, who almost became a priest, founded this group named after a hotel in Holland. In his eulogy in the Times of London, it said that Joseph Rettinger was called the Eminence Greis, founded the Bilderberg Group. Whenever documentaries or books talk of the Bilderberg, Joseph Rettinger is barely mentioned. He seems to be airbrushed out of history, where his grave is plain and quiet in a cemetery in West London. But how did Joseph Rettinger describe his upbringing and his early connections to Rome? These are his own words in his own memoirs. "In 1924, wrote Rettinger, I became imbued with the idea of the unity of Europe. My guardian after my father's death was Count Ladislaw Zamoyski, the head of one of the richest and oldest Polish families. Zamoyski was brought up by his mother, one of Poland's great ladies, a pillar of Catholicism and of the patriotic tradition. Through Zamoyski, I met some of the most distinguished Catholic clergymen in France, of whom I remember best Monseigneur Bourillard, at that time rector of the Catholic University of Paris, and later a cardinal, a round, rosy-cheeked, smiling, venerable prelate, an honest man an eminent scholar and a famous historian. To a young man like myself, educated in a devout Catholic atmosphere, another person whom I got in touch was the general of the Jesuits, Count Ledetroisky, a Pole and a friend of my guardian, Count Zamoyski. Rettinger's personal biographer said that the approach to the Vatican was a more difficult proposition. Fortunately, Rettinger found that there was a man who could help. This was Dr. Luigi Gedda, an intimate friend of and medical advisor to Pope Pius XII and head of the powerful Azione Cattolica, at that time the power behind ruling Christian Democratic Party. Rettinger did not know him, but an introduction was easily arranged. They met, dined, and established an immediate rapport. Gedda agreed to give Rettinger his full support. He agreed to talk to the Pope and prepare the ground for the Curia. Dr. Luigi Gedda, in the center, the medical advisor to Pope Pius XII, who stands in white on the right, was Rettinger's link to the Vatican. And though Rettinger may not have got their full support, he was still fulfilling the papacy's agenda by attempting to integrate the continent of Europe.
Agli uomini e alle donne mafiosi. Per favore, cambiate di vita. Convertitevi. Fermatevi di fare il male.
A week ago Saturday, he excommunicated the mafia. Now, they've been talking about this for a couple of hundred years, and this man just stepped up and did it.
Praise God.
What Kenneth Copeland and Pope Francis I failed to tell us is that men like Charles Lucky Luciano, the Sicilian-born American crime mobster responsible for the early flow of heroin and heroin addicts in the United States, and Sam Giancana, one of the famous mafia crime bosses, was, as his family confirms in his biography titled Double Cross, like all mafia families from its inception, connected to the Vatican, where he did business with Michele Sindona, the Jesuit-educated Italian economic wizard and financial advisor to the Vatican, who was himself financed by the enormous profits of the film series that glamorized the Vatican Mafia Alliance.
The Godfather, Part 3. The ultimate story of family.
Don Corleone. The Corleone family. Partners with the Pope. They may cry blasphemy.
This is business.
The papacy has sympathy from heads of state all over Europe, where successive Italian leaders such as Romano Prodi recognizes papal supremacy when he met the late Pope John Paul II with his family. Silvio Berlusconi, the media tycoon and three times Prime Minister of Italy, met Pope Benedict XVI and recognizes papal supremacy. Bilderberg Italian economist Mario Monti met Pope Francis I and recognizes papal supremacy before he left office. And Giorgio Napolitano, the longest serving president in the history of the Italian Republic, recognizes papal supremacy. And Angela Merkel, the Chancellor of Germany, knows she needs the Catholic vote in her homeland, also recognizes papal supremacy. But what does the papacy, the richest organization on earth, gain from maintaining political ties with Italy and Germany? David Yalop is considered as one of the best investigative journalists in the world. He wrote a book titled The Power and the Glory, and you can get a picture why people are sometimes very hostile to the churches, especially the papacy. For the year 2000, the Roman Catholic Church in Italy received 1,500 billion lire, approximately $750 million or nearly £500 million. In the same year, the money that went to the German Roman Catholic Church from the German taxpayers, similar system, was 9.1 billion Deutschmarks or $4.5 billion or £3 billion. In Old Blighty, better known as the United Kingdom, secular Britain has no clue of its own history. It was Avro Manhattan and his brilliant investigative research skills that opened the eyes of his mentor, English historian H.G. Wells, who, like Manhattan, worked for the British government during the Second World War. Wells said that the history of England since the Reformation could be written as a recurrent and a generally combined attack on the Roman Catholic Church. Guy Fawkes was once renowned as the most famous Roman Catholic terrorist in English and world history. But thanks to the film V for Vendetta, he has now become the poster child for global revolution. How clever. You could even go into supermarkets in the UK and find his image displayed with fireworks. Though Adolf Hitler was a Roman Catholic, never excommunicated, and all the heads of fascist Europe also, the Vatican has blamed both Britain and the United States Protestant countries for failing to stop the Holocaust, reversing the guilt. Will any historian challenge her? Of course not.
I'll be fine.
This is the front line, boys. Catholics and Protestants living side by side at each other's throats. Divided by the Divis flats. But do not enter the flats. They've become very dangerous.
Hold the line!
Retreat! The troubles in Ireland between the English and the Irish were horrific. But every now and then, an article will come out that shows that the Roman Catholic clergy were not only stirring the conflict, but instrumental in assisting the IRA in setting off bombs. Will she be challenged? Of course not. When Pope Benedict XVI came to Britain in September 2010, though the media downplayed it, for they protected his image, the British public were enraged. For in the midst of an economic crisis, when people were struggling to make ends meet, and foreign troops are on foreign soil in two wars, the British government paid for his trip, where his visit will last for 4 days and will cost up to £20 million, of which £12 million will be paid by British taxpayers. The British Catholic newspaper even confirmed that British foreign aid money to help the poor around the world was used to finance Benedict XVI's trip. The First Kingdom, the papacy, is just having a field day with these so-called secular governments. But let us now turn our attention to France, considered as the most secular state in Europe. When François Hollande, the President of France, visited Pope Francis I in the Vatican, the body language alone shows that there is a definite hostility, which is totally different from France's early days with the papacy. When the Frankish King Clovis was baptized in 508 AD, France became the first kingdom to convert and give allegiance to the papacy and the Pope of Rome, becoming its eldest child. But what made it turn on the papacy that led to that bloody revolution? Why did this child rebel from its mother? And what were the different religious, political, and social mechanisms that led to a revolution that not only affected France, but the entire world? Well, we need to dig up the archives. From the 11th century AD, France burned out any trace of apostolic Christianity, said there was no trace of it, but then she took it to a whole new level. When the film The Kingdom of Heaven was released, the Vatican and her secular slaves condemned it, calling it a marketing tool for Al-Qaeda and the late Osama bin Laden. Though you can't expect pinpoint historical accuracy from the sensationalism of Hollywood, it basically saw that the Crusades was a merciless bloodbath. But what European nation stayed its course from start to finish? This Jesuit priest with a panel of Catholic apologists attempt to defend the Crusades, but give an insight into what nation led the assault.
The reason that they're there is a devotional reason. They're there because they want to do something that is good, because they are themselves intently sinful people. They know how much they're sinful, and they know that they need a great deal of penance to pay for those sins. These are professional warriors. They live their life by the sword, and they know they have a hard row to hoe to get into heaven.
Yeah.
That's what's leading them.
Call, and the only person to issue a call to at that time was the Pope. So he appealed to Western Europe. And the Pope, Pope Urban II, to them, it was the Franks mainly who went on this crusade.
And again, so folks understand, the Franks are the barbarian tribe that invaded Gaul, the Roman province of Gaul.
Well, they were barbarian before they became Christian.
Like everybody else down there.
Yes, indeed.
they were all barbarians, you know. And the Franks were a particular tribe of barbarians that prospered and did well, became France, but that they were the bulk.
I think it's important to realize, too, that they were actually volunteers. They weren't being paid to go on a crusade. They were doing it because of their love of Christianity.
This image is of the French Pope Urban II rallying up the papal dignitaries into that geopolitical bloodbath that still has left an unhealed wound in the Orient, the Middle East. Philip Schaff was a Swiss-born, German-educated Protestant theologian who taught in the United States and left a volume of well-researched works. In his History of the Christian Church, Volume 5, we get a verification of that papal panel discussion. He said that the Crusaders sought the living among the dead. They mistook the visible for the invisible, confused the terrestrial and the celestial Jerusalem, and returned disillusioned. They learned in Jerusalem, or after ages have learned through them, that Christ is not there, that he is risen and ascended into heaven, where he sits at the head of a spiritual kingdom. The Crusades failed in three respects. The Holy Land was not won. The advance of Islam was not permanently checked. The schism between the East and the West was not healed. These were the primary objects of the Crusades. The Crusades began and ended in France. The French element was the ruling factor, from Urban II, who was a native of Châtillon near Reims, and Peter of Amiens to St. Louis. The contemporary accounts of the Crusades were for the most part written by Frenchmen. Gilbert of Nugent and other chronicles regard them as especially the work of their countrymen. The French expression outre-mer was used for the goal of the Crusades. Though the whole of Western Europe fought in the Crusades, the driving force was France. But it wasn't just the Arab world that was to feel the wrath of the papacy. Those in Europe, especially in France, were also going to be a target. What would happen if the public, and not just academics only, were to get access to the ever so secretive Vatican archives and the Vatican Library? The modern world would see history in a completely different light. H.G. Wells, unlike modern day papal apologists who defend the papacy, said that the Crusades were the direct work of the Church. His young protege, Avro Manhattan, knew that Christians that practiced primitive apostolic Christianity were a target. He said that in the Dark and Middle Ages, whoever dared to think independently of Catholicism was mercilessly silenced by Catholic sword and fire. but that didn't stop people. John Fox was a 16th century English chronicler and historian. He collated extracts from 223 authentic documents that comprised of decrees, decretals, extravagants, pontificals, papal bulls, private manuscripts, episcopal registers, and state documents to compile acts and monuments, better known as Fox's Book of Martyrs, and he documented one of France's early reformers. Peter Waldo was a native of Lyons in France. He was a very rich merchant who sold all of his riches and wealth for the spreading of the gospel and for producing Bibles. This scholar who labeled the Pope the Antichrist, when challenged by the Bishop of Lyons, said he ought to obey God rather than men, and he had to eventually flee for his life and dwelt among an already existing community called the Waldenses. These Christians worshipped in southern France in a place called Albi, where they got their name, the Albigenses. But they also spread in the provinces of Dauphine, Provence, Languedoc, or Gascogne. Carcassonne was a well-fortified city with a beautiful landscape and snow-capped mountains in the background. It is a UNESCO World Heritage Site and is considered as the most fortified and well-preserved medieval city in Western Europe. But the Crusaders were to besiege it, cut off the water supply, and take captive its inhabitants, and eventually fabricate their history. But one man was to rescue their history from oblivion and give them their rightful place. This is the gravestone of the best European historian who brilliantly chronicled history from the Caesars to the 19th century with such precise a detail. James Aitken Wiley has such a brilliant mind and was able to analyze history with a moral and deeply intelligent mind. In his History of Protestantism, published in the 19th century, he gave a solid account of the Albigenses in France. This is a bit lengthy. The Albigenses and other sects springing up at her door were more dangerous foes of the papacy than the Saracens of the distant East. The France of those days, the 12th and 13th centuries, was parted into four grand divisions. It is the most subtly of the four, or Nabongor, to which our attention is now to be turned. To the riches of the soil were added the wealth of commerce, further embellished by the numerous castles of a powerful nobility. The lively and poetic genius of the people had enabled them to form a language of their own, namely the Provencal. In richness of vocables, softness of cadence, and picturesqueness of idiom, the Provencal excelled all the languages of Europe and promised the universal tongue of Christendom. Best of all, a pure Christianity was developing in the region. Foremost among these was the translation of the New Testament into the Provencal, the earliest of all our modern-day versions of the scriptures. The hour of a great revolt against Rome appeared to be near. Surrounded by the fostering influence of art, intelligence, and liberty, primitive Christianity was here powerfully developing itself. It seemed verily that the 13th and not the 16th century would be the date of the Reformation, and that its cradle would be placed not in Germany, but in the south of France. The penetrating and far-seeing eye of Innocent III saw all this very clearly. He issued an edict enjoining the extermination of all heretics. Cities would be drowned in blood. Kings would be laid waste. Art and civilization would perish, and the progress of the world would be rolled back for centuries, but not otherwise could the movement be arrested and Rome saved. In the exposition made by the Bishop of Tournai of the errors of the Albigenses, says Sismondi, we find nearly all the principles on which Luther and Calvin found the Reformation of the 16th century. Lotario de Conti de Segni, better known as Pope Innocent III, the Prince of Darkness, was a true manifestation of Satan. Pompous, big-headed, a murderer from the beginning, for he that hateth his brother is a murderer, who feared light and wanted to extinguish it at all costs if it posed a threat to his own glory. He appointed Dominic, the father of the Dominicans, the Black Friars, his alter ego, to spearhead the Inquisition, where the Albigenses were a prime target, and the blood of the martyrs became the seed of the church. They burned all of their literature, that also included the Holy Scriptures, a threat to papal authority, so there will be no trace or record of their history. Dominic also had the Albigenses burned, so there was no trace of them either. Did Jesus instruct the disciples to massacre those who differed in belief from them? What is the justification? Weak historians will say, well, that was the mood of the times. From the death of Christ till this very day, there is absolutely no excuse of Christians massacring anyone. It is totally contrary to the life of Jesus and the Gospels. Here are the remains of the castle that was assaulted in those crusades in southern France. It is in ruins. This is what is left of the legacy of that race of people who are trying to restore the apostolic faith. But secular historians sympathize with the bloodbaths of Rome. John Fox, an eminent scholar and chronicler, documented in his works that secular historians label as anti-Catholic propaganda the legacy of this people whose history is lost in time. He said that the Albigenses were a people of the Reformed religion who inhabited the country of Albi. They were condemned on account of religion in the Council of Lateran by order of Pope Alexander III, but they increased so rapidly that many cities were inhabited exclusively by persons of their persuasions, and several eminent noblemen embraced their doctrines. In the 1911 edition of the Roman Catholic Encyclopedia, Volume 1, the papacy discredits the legacy of this God-fearing people in southern France. Albigenses, from Albi, Latin Albiga, the present capital of the department of Tara, a neo-Manichean sect that flourished in southern France in the 12th and 13th centuries. They were also called Catharists, though in reality they were only a branch of the Catharist movement. What a complete lie. Those were false accusations made by the papacy, the Albigenses' enemies. But just look how the papacy can manipulate history and win people over to cover a multitude of sins that includes its genocidal bloodbaths. In the most exhaustive study and research book on secret societies, titled Occult Theocracy, published in 1930, the author, Edith Starr Miller, also known as Lady Queensborough, though a Christian, she embraced not the reformers John Fox's account of the Albigenses, but the false account of the Catholic Church. She said, as to the Albigenses, their name derived from Albi, a term of Languedoc, covered not one, but many sects issued from Manichaeism and Arianism, and counted also many Jews or Judaized Christians. Under the appellation of Albigenses, historians, that is false ones, whether political or religious, have almost unanimously included Cathars. This is so false and unfair, but it should give you a picture of how the papacy can murder, massacre, and annihilate men, women, and children, distort their history, and have weak historians sympathize with her. Let us quote one more source, the 1973 edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica, Volume 1. It reads, Albigenses. The name, derived from the city of Albi, of, and listen to the language, heretical sect in southern France in the 12th and 13th centuries, against which a crusade was launched in 1209. Though the papacy crushed this apostolic revival, a couple of centuries later, another one was to emerge in the 16th century. France, unbeknownst to many, had one of the greatest impacts on the Reformation through one of its finest intellects. The history of the Huguenots, the name given to French Protestants, are recorded in these books. This monument, known as the Reformation Wall, or the International Monument to the Reformation, in Geneva, Switzerland, has in the center John Calvin and his protege Theodore Beza, two Frenchmen. It was constructed in the grounds of the University of Geneva, which was founded by John Calvin. John Calvin was the most influential of all the reformers and the most successful, having more influence in the English-speaking world than in his native France. His theology, based upon a thorough knowledge of the scriptures, a thus saith the Lord, was biblical rather than ritualistic or scholastic. When the Puritans left Plymouth in England in 1620 to travel to the New World, they were all Calvinists in their thinking, their theology, and their strict, straight-cut living. And unbeknownst to the citizens of the United States, its moral fiber is based on Calvinistic theology. The Scottish reformer John Knox, known as the Thundering Scot, who is also on the Reformation Wall, was also a Calvinist in his strict theology. In England, though William Tyndale's Bible was the fulcrum on which balanced the entire English Reformation, as two authors put it, Oliver Cromwell, the Lord Protector, who briefly made England a Commonwealth Republic, was a staunch Calvinist. John Milton, Cromwell's Secretary of State and famous poet, was also a Calvinist. And in Bunhyan Fields, in the city of London, is a grave of another 17th century Englishman who was temporarily jailed for his faith, John Bunyan, the author of the famous Pilgrim's Progress, another Calvinist. This is how vast his influence was, and Baptists, Presbyterians, Congregationalists, the Huguenots in France, and the Dutch and German Reformed are all Calvinistic. As a reformer, he didn't purge out all of papal teachings. He reintroduced the Augustinian teachings of predestination, once saved, always saved, a dogma that has no scriptural support, though many think that it does. And Michael Servetus, the Spanish theologian, was arrested in Geneva and burnt at the stake for his differing views as a result of Calvin's no-nonsense attitude. John Calvin had a protege in Geneva who, like Calvin, left France, and at the age of 40 in 1559, Theodore Beza became the first rector of the University of Geneva in Switzerland, which had been founded by Calvin. When one of the three committees were translating the King James Version of the Bible, they were using the codexes of Theodore Beza that he donated to Cambridge University in 1581. Calvin's influence was spreading like wildfire throughout Europe, whose educational institutions were spreading rapidly. But in France, another movement was rising that was designed to crush or the influence of the Protestant Reformation. In the University of Paris, also known as La Sorbonne, a Spanish nobleman and former soldier was gathering together a number of men to form a new order to save the papacy of being a past relic. This Spanish Basque name was Don Inigo Lopez de Recald, who was born at the castle of Loyola in Spain. He is better known as Ignatius de Loyola. And this monk soldier in 1534, at the age of 40, was to gather in one of the oldest churches in France a group of men who called themselves the Society of Jesus. The men in black were labeled as the Jesuits by their Protestant enemies, either in Germany or in France, but the name which had stigma at first stuck, and they wore it as a badge of honor. Ignatius presented his credentials to Pope Paul III in 1540, and they were only meant to exist for a temporary basis, but they were so successful that they continued and were titled the Militae Regimini, the Militant Regiment of the Church, the Shock Troops of Rome. They took over the Inquisition, and though they produced a number of intellectuals and academic institutions, what they couldn't cope with intelligently, they destroyed. Why doesn't the generation of today know anything about them or European history? The Jesuits have learned to cover their tracks by carefully going into libraries and second-hand bookshops and destroying works that would enlighten anyone of their operations. But I believe that in the end, the truth will conquer. And before we go into France, let us briefly look at Asia. The Jesuits spread all over Asia, especially into Japan, where they infiltrated themselves into the samurai culture and formed an alliance with one of Japan's dictators, the shogun Oda Nobunaga. Many of these Jesuits were welcomed into the courts, for they were gifted and skilled at the sciences, but that was a wedge to control the culture in Asia. But many Japanese leaders caught wind of the Jesuit agenda, and they knew it was not to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, but it was an agenda of papal-led Western imperialism, and many of the Jesuits were massacred in record numbers by the samurai culture of Japan. Today, the Jesuits call these men martyrs, but secular writer Avram Manhattan, unlike most secular sympathetic papal apologists, knew exactly why the Japanese beheaded and expelled the Jesuits from their islands, and he gave the true historical account of what really took place. Manhattan said the Jesuits were determined to plant the spiritual and cultural power of the church in Southeast Asia. They attempted with varied success to influence the cultural and political top echelons of society. These missionaries found a powerful protector in Nobunaga, the military dictator of Japan. Japanese civil rulers began to realize that the Catholic Church was not only a religion, but a political power intimately connected with the imperialist expansion of Catholic countries like Portugal, Spain, and other Western nations. Whenever Japanese Catholics formed a majority, the Buddhists and members of other local faiths suffered. Not only were they boycotted, but their temples were closed and, when not destroyed, were seized and converted into churches. In 1587, Hideyoshi visited Kyushu and, to his astonishment, found that the Catholic community had carried out the most appalling religious persecution. Everywhere he saw the ruins of Buddhist temples and broken Buddhist idols. The Catholics, in fact, had forcibly attempted to make the whole island of Kyushu totally Catholic. But the Italian Catholic director, Martin Scorsese, has been working on a project for 10 years, a film called Silence, that portrays the Jesuits as martyrs in Japan, due for release in November 2015, and it will star Liam Neeson and Spider-Man Andrew Garfield, who, as the English Catholic press confirms, is studying Jesuit books to prepare him for the leading role in this film. This isn't the first time Hollywood has glorified the Jesuits. In the 1986 film The Mission, the Jesuits are portrayed as peace-loving missionaries.
With an orchestra, the Jesuits could have subdued the whole continent. So it was that the Indians of the Guarani were brought finally to account to the everlasting mercy of God and to the short-lived mercy of man.
Let us now go back to France so we can get a clearer picture of what led to the build-up of that provoked 18th century revolution in France. Edmond Paris was a French historical philosopher born in Paris into a Roman Catholic family who studied at the University of Paris, the Sorbonne, but he observed history and current events with a balanced eye and dug deeper than other intellectuals. King Henry III of France, known for his large gold earrings, was a moderate who avoided any wars at all costs, who was sympathetic to the Protestant Huguenots in France. He was murdered by a Jesuit assassin, a young Dominican monk, Jacques Clement, because of his alliance with his cousin, Henry of Navarre, the leader of the Huguenots. Henry of Navarre, who later became King Henry IV of France, was baptized a Catholic but raised a Protestant. He was very sympathetic to the Protestants having religious liberty in France, and this plaque shows the Edict of Nantes of 1598, which was a decree that gave liberty to the Protestants in France and allowed them to worship freely. The Jesuits were not impressed with Henry's leniency towards the Protestants, and after two failed assassination attempts, a Jesuit assassin, Francois Ravaillac, who Wikipedia cleverly calls a Catholic fanatic, committed regicide and killed him. And Edmond Paris records that he confessed that he had been inspired by the writings of two Spanish Jesuits, Francisco Suarez on the left and Juan de Mariana on the right, who both taught that the murder of heretic tyrants was justified if they conflicted with papal interests.
Marguerite de Valois, acceptes-tu pour époux Henri de Bourbon, roi de Navarre? Au nom du Père, au nom du Fils et au nom de la Sainte Église, je vous déclare mari et femme.
Queen Margot was a film that was released that records one of the worst crimes against humanity that took place just prior to the assassination of the two French monarchs previously mentioned. The August 22nd, 1572 Saint Bartholomew's Massacre, a Catholic-led bloodbath that was not just led by the monarchy, but by the highest dignitaries in the Vatican. Gaspard de Coligny was one of the highest French noblemen in the land, and he was a Huguenot. With his brothers, these men held a powerful sway in that French culture. But Gaspard de Coligny was to be one of the victims, where they forcefully entered into his house and brutally murdered him. Sir Francis Walsingham, the father of modern-day secret intelligence, and the English ambassador to Paris before he was the Secretary of State under Queen Elizabeth I, was an eyewitness to the massacre, viewing it from his ambassadorial apartment. But who was the mastermind of this massacre? In a book that has been endorsed by the Jesuits, titled The Power and Secret of the Jesuits by René Philip Miller, we get a clear picture. Catherine de' Medici, who governed in the name of the new king, a minor, might well have vacillated between the Huguenot and Catholic parties, but an earnest and forceful discourse by the Jesuit general, Lainez, at the ecclesiastical colloquy at Poissy, so far influenced the queen regent as to cause her to lean more and more towards the Catholics. Make no concessions to heresy, Lainez had declared, addressing himself to the Queen Regent, but rather uphold the Catholic faith with all your authority. Then will God, mindful of your piety, preserve to you your earthly kingdom and admit you to the kingdom of heaven. If, however, on the other hand, you are unmindful of your duties towards God, then tremble lest, together with the heavenly kingdom, you lose also your earthly kingdom. This painting shows Catherine Medici with dead French Protestant Huguenots at the Saint Bartholomew's Massacre, which shows she gave in to the spiritual abuse of the Jesuit general, Lainez. Historians delete the black pope's Diego Lainez' role in the St. Bartholomew's Massacre, and the white pope, Gregory XIII, struck a medal in commemoration of that Roman Catholic bloodbath in France. Cardinal Reclus, a French nobleman, was ambitious and knew that the only hindrance to control France were the Huguenots, so he led the siege of La Rochelle from 1625 to 1628 that destroyed a whole Protestant city that was on an equal footing with Paris. King Louis XIV, the Sun King, led the last and final assault against the Huguenots in France. On the advice of his Jesuit confessor, Friar Lachaise, to ethnically cleanse the Huguenots, he intimidated them by using the dragonnades to enforce them to be Catholics, face persecution, or flee. Louis XIV struck medals in commemoration of this bloodbath, and many Huguenots fled for their life throughout Europe and even into the United States of America. With the greatest traders and industrialists expelled from the country, and with poor peasants and an absolute power invested into the monarchy, the groundwork was now ripe for that bloody revolution in France. France, the oldest child of the papacy who dominated the Crusades and ethnically cleansed the Albigenses and the Calvinistic Huguenots, was to turn on its mother, the First Kingdom. What goes around, comes around. At the beginning of the study, it was shown that the papacy was prophetically called the Great City. This region in Western Europe is called the Ten Horns or Kingdoms in Daniel chapter 7 verses 7 and 20, and Revelation chapter 13 and verse 1, and chapter 17 and verse 3. Sir Isaac Newton, whose exhaustive studies on the mysteries of life that not only included science, but also included Bible prophecy, verified this. I have now enumerated the ten kingdoms into which the Western Empire became divided at its first breaking, that is, at the time of Romans besieged and taken by the Goths. Some of these kingdoms at length fell, and new ones arose. But whatever was their number afterwards, they are still called the ten kings from their first number. One of these ten kingdoms was going to revolt, and the French Revolution is prophesied in the 11th chapter of the book of Revelation, and we shall just touch on a portion of it and see that over 100 years leading up to the revolution, godly men who drank heavily from the fountain of the Holy Scriptures foresaw the revolt in Northern Europe. Revelation chapter 11 and verse 13 says, "At the same hour was there a great earthquake, and the tenth part of the city fell, and in the earthquake were slain of men 7,000, and the remnant were affrighted and gave glory to the God of heaven." The language of the King James Bible can be sometimes quite difficult for the modern mind to take in. But in a summary, the tenth part of the city, or one of the ten kingdoms, was to revolt against the papacy, that great city, where thousands were to be slain or slaughtered. In the works of Thomas Goodwin, This Bible scholar, who lived from 1600 to 1680 AD, foresaw that this was talking about a revolution in France. What he records is fascinating. By the earthquake here, which is said to be a great one, is meant, as still in the book it is, a great concussion or shaking of states, politic or ecclesiastical, for of either or of both it is used. The effect of this earthquake and fall of this tenth part of the city is the killing 7,000 of the names of men. So it is in the original. Now, which of these 10 kingdoms or of the 10 states in Europe and what tenth part thereof shall first have this great privilege? One of these 10 European kingdoms that have given up their power unto the beast shall now in this slaughter begin to fall from and cease to be a part of the city, or to belong to the jurisdiction of Rome any longer. The saints and churches belonging unto the kingdom of France, God hath made a wonder unto me, have ever since had as great a share in persecutions, greater than any other churches. Very interesting. Robert Fleming Jr. was a Scottish Presbyterian minister who lived from around 1660 to 1716. He also did a lecture in 1701 forewarning of the revolution in France from studying Bible prophecy. Among the French Huguenots, they were not just industrialists and traders, but they were also students of Bible prophecy. And Pierre Giraud, a French Huguenot Protestant, also knew from reading Revelation chapter 11 that a revolution was to strike his native France. He said, "Now what is this tenth part of the city which shall fall? In my opinion, we cannot doubt that it is France. This kingdom is the most considerable part or piece of the 10 horns or states which once made up the great Babylonian city." Bishop Thomas Newton was an English cleric, the Bishop of Bristol, who lived from 1704 to 1782. He was a deep Bible scholar, and he also identified, though he saw it in the past and not the future. The great earthquake and the falling of the tenth part of the city and the slaying of thousands of men, according to this hypothesis, must be referred to the great commotions and civil wars which for several years afterwards cruelly disturbed and almost destroyed the kingdom of France. After the revolution, in a brilliant scholarly work called The Approaching End of the Age, which teaches how to study Bible prophecy, Dr. Henry Grattan Guinness, an Irish-born Protestant missionary and evangelist who lived from 1835 to 1910, details what led up to the revolution. France had taken rank as the first of papal nations ever since the conversion of Clovis and the donations of Pepin and Charlemagne. France had taken a leading place in opposition to the glorious Reformation. By the iron heel of power, she had crushed down the new life and had extinguished the rekindled gospel light of the glad era. In the massacre of Saint Bartholomew, she had all but extirpated Protestantism. And by the revocation of the Edict of Nantes, she had banished from her shores her surviving Huguenot subjects. France was for more than 1,000 years a main pillar of the popedom in France. The middle of the 18th century saw the beginning of a marvelous change in France. It is regarded by historians as the era of the French Revolution. In less than a century from 1750, this first of papal nations had become madly and violently anti-papal. And this most servilely superstitious people had become openly and even fiercely infidel. France ceased to be Catholic and became infidel, and infidel France, having thrown off all restraints of law and order, natural and divine, plunged before the end of the century into the maddest excesses of revolution and crime. The beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit that attacked the two witnesses in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom for its sexual depravity, and Egypt, a state that totally rejected God, was the prophetic description of the state of France during the revolution, where they also adopted a 10-day calendar like Egypt, and paraded in France the woman of reason. That was an outward rejection of God and his word that French Freemasons eventually gave as a gift to the United States, the Statue of Liberty, as many of the founding fathers were very Francophone in their thinking. Let us pause for a second. Men in Western Europe who drank heavily from the fountain of the Holy Scriptures and were guided by the spirit of prophecy foresaw that an ungodly anarchistic revolution was to sweep through the country of France. This is no Nostradamus speculation, but Jesus Christ foretelling his people what is to come upon the earth. Many Christians, which may be surprising to many, and unbelievers have said, if God is all-powerful and all-knowing and can see into the future, why does he allow all these horrible things to happen on the earth? But the question you have to ask yourself, if you have been forewarned of what's to come, example the rise and fall of the two kingdoms and their eventual destruction at the second coming of Christ, then what is your excuse to be lost? There is none. No excuse for you and no excuse for me. Don't let no one deceive you into believing.
We can stop Judgment Day from happening.
For the remaining prophecies still stand, and the secret things belong unto the Lord our God. But those things which are revealed, prophecy, belong unto us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. Let us now go back to France and the influence of this revolution. Napoleon Bonaparte, though a Corsican, rode on the wind of the French Revolution, and unbeknownst to himself was fulfilling Bible prophecy, striking a deadly wound to the papacy. One of his top men, Chief of Staff or Major General Louis-Alexandre Berthier, marched into Rome, arrested the Pope and stripped him of his fisherman's ring and his temporal power, and what goes around comes around, or the prophetic description of the papacy's humility is, he that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Pope Pius VI died in captivity in 1799 to prophetic precision, and guess where? In France, the oldest and the most faithful child of the papacy. What impact did that revolution have on surrounding states and the rest of the world? James Aitken Wiley knew that the spirit of the revolution did not die out at all, and that it was rekindled, but he gives the reason why in his essay turned book, The Papacy, published in 1852. The papacy at this moment is fighting its third great battle. Its third great war is that which is now waging with an atheistic communism, which has risen contemporaneously and with extraordinary intensity and power, and in all the Catholic countries of Europe. Whence has come this new and destructive principle? It is the natural issue of the bondage in which the human mind has so long been retained, of the violence done to reason and faith. For superstition is the parent of atheism. The national mind in France long struggled to find vent through means of Christianity. This was denied it. It next sought liberty in skepticism, which speedily terminated in atheism. With French infidelity came French democracy. The democratic element entered the world with Christianity, and revived again in the Reformation of John Calvin. There is this difference, however, that whereas the doctrine of Calvin would have given true liberty, constitutional government to Europe, the doctrine of Voltaire gave it an anarchy which baptized itself in blood. Skepticism, engendered thus from superstition, has overspread Europe and set free the masses from all divine control and, by necessary consequence, from all earthly authority. The brood of revolutions which now torment Europe is the progeny of Rome. The popular vengeance was directed full against the priesthood in the first French Revolution, because the priesthood had been thoroughly identified with the government. The late revolution has produced a reaction among the upper classes in favor of the church. The French Revolution, after Napoleon had extinguished it in blood, as all men believed, has returned from its tomb refreshed by its sleep of half a century to do battle with the dynasties and hierarchies of Europe. The revolution swept through the continent of Europe, but it was the philosophies of the beast that ascended out of the bottomless pit which will impact Western culture till this day. Jean-Jacques Rousseau, the 18th century Swiss-French Enlightenment philosopher's writings are considered as the most influential of the 18th century in political and social theory and literature. He taught the natural goodness of man and rejected the concept of sin. These ideas were to influence German rationalism, where Friedrich Nietzsche, the German philosopher who eventually had a nervous breakdown, took Rousseau's views to a whole new level with his The Death of God philosophy. He became the father of existentialism that would develop into the ideology of postmodernism, which teaches that each person is free to decide their own truth and their own morality. If it feels good, it's right. François-Marie Ariot, better known as Voltaire, was a contemporary of Rousseau, an 18th century French Enlightenment writer who is considered as the spiritual godfather of the French Revolution. His violently anti-biblical views was to also influence another German who was inspired by the French Revolution, Karl Marx, whose anti-religious views also has a huge impact, not only in the 20th century, but even in the 21st also. But Napoleon Bonaparte of France was to crown himself emperor, and he did it in the presence of Pope Pius VII in humiliation of his authority. But though France was liberating the Franks from papal rule, across the Atlantic Ocean, others caught wind of the revolution, and they liberated themselves from France. This fortress high up in the mountains is surrounded by a beautiful plush scenery of green. On a close inspection inside this fortress, it is full of cannons to ward off any enemy attack by the French, and they can be found all over this fortress. This well-built and fortified structure was constructed by a man named Henry Christophe, the leader of a Caribbean island that became the very first modern-day Black Republic, Haiti, one of the few islands that has its indigenous name. This is the palace of Henry Christophe, and it is very clear that he was a man of high taste. The Haitian Revolution was a revolt by African slaves against French rule, and it was successful. Some of its heroes were men like Jean-Baptiste Belli, who was born in Senegal in West Africa, taken as a slave at the age of 2, and who eventually fought in the Haitian Revolution, and then eventually became a member of the French National Convention. But the most famous leader was a man nicknamed the Black Napoleon, François-Dominique Toussaint Louverture, whose military genius led that slave revolt which declared Haiti a separate republic from French colonial rule. This general is still respected, not just in black circles, but in modern-day France. But in his day, just like in the days of the Bible, for a man to be defeated by a woman was the highest level of shame and embarrassment. And in the days of slavery, for blacks, who were considered as inferiors, to defeat white Europeans, who were considered as the superior race, was a great humiliation. So Napoleon tricked him by inviting him to France, where he jailed him. The embarrassment was just too much for Napoleon's pride. But the revolution in Haiti sent ripples in South America, and it touched another revolutionary, Simon Bolivar, and he wanted it to have a greater impact than the one in North America.
El verdadero destino del hombre es la libertad. La voluntad de ser libre es un impulso innato.
Your vision of democracy is exactly what Washington and Jefferson promised.
Yes, it is. It's not only for white men. It's for all men.
The invasion. They massacred the first Americans and enslaved the continent for 300 years.
Este continente está esperando por un diluvio. Un diluvio que finalmente lo inunde de libertad.
Y ese diluvio comienza hoy.
Hoy proclamamos la Gran República Americana de Colombia.
The Second Kingdom, the United States, started to rise when the first beast, the papacy, went into captivity. And there is no question that France had a profound influence on those men who wanted to separate those 13 colonies from British rule. This painting from the Revolution shows Jean-Jacques Rousseau above the all-seeing eye and the French flags. The all-seeing eye is now one of the insignias of the seal of the United States, a clear French influence. This painting shows Voltaire in the center, blessing the grandson of Benjamin Franklin, who stands on the left, a man heavily influenced by France. The Declaration of Independence of 1776 separated the 13 colonies and was the beginning of what today we call the United States. But it was the wars of independence in that embryonic nation that fully severed those colonies from the clutch of the English crown that led North America of becoming a republic, a nation without a monarch, no king, no pope. And George Washington became its first officially elected president of the United States. But from looking at modern day video games, an extension of US military propaganda, we can get a clear picture of what the United States is planning to do. Conquer the entire earth. But the question we have to ask, on whose behalf? Avro Manhattan, though a secular writer, foresaw the danger of an alliance of the two kingdoms. He wrote a book that was so solid it was rejected by 55 publishers in both the United States and Great Britain, but became a number one bestseller that went into 47 editions. It was called The Vatican in World Politics, published just after the Second World War, and he documented what would be the future effects of an alignment between the two kingdoms. The United States of America, being the most powerful, wealthy, and active country in the Western Hemisphere, has quickly become the undisputed leader of the American countries, and even before the Second World War, it was obviously destined to be one of the most powerful countries, if not the most powerful country, in the world. On July the 29th, 1939, Cardinal Enrico Gasparri arrived in New York and spent 3 days with Archbishop Spelman, his mission being to repair the juridical status for the possible opening of diplomatic relations between the State Department and the Holy See. on the day the United States of America has an ambassador to the Vatican. The Vatican will be entitled to have a representative in Washington who will officially address the president on behalf not only of Vatican City, an independent miniature state, but of the Roman Catholic citizens of the United States, and furthermore, on behalf of the 400 million Roman Catholics all over the world. Today, it is in its billions. What would this mean? That the Constitution of the United States of America would crumble to the ground, and that the separation of the state from the church would be gone forever. How much of such pressure will the fast disintegrating Protestant churches stand? For how long would the Constitution be left unaltered and the separation of church and state be allowed to remain one of the fundamental pillars of the United States? What then should happen to American principles of liberty of conscience, of the individual, of religion, and all those other aspects of freedom that are now an integral part of American life? Avro Manhattan also saw that the man who provoked the First and Second World War, Eugenio P. Kelly, who later became Pope Pius XII, formed an unholy alliance with John Foster Dulles, the US Secretary of State, that led to the Cold War. And this cozy relationship of the two kingdoms will eventually lead to the worst levels of global draconianism in the history of man, according to Revelation chapter 13, verses 12 to 17. And in order for the United States to fulfill her prophetic destiny, she has to unwind the foundation of her liberties. Elihu Vedder was an American symbolist painter. He painted a picture that represented the American government in 1896 that is situated in the lobby in the main reading room in the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C. And in the center it reads, "A government of the people, by the people, for the people. Democracy." Opposite Parliament Square in London, England, is a statue of President Abraham Lincoln. He is credited with coining that phrase, but it was not his words. These are the words of the evangelical doctor, the 14th century Oxford scholar, and the morning star of the Reformation, whose introduction or prologue to his Bible said, "The Bible is the government of the people, by the people, and for the people," which shows that the foundation of modern day liberties is the Bible and its restoration at the Reformation. This has been confirmed in the British newspaper and even in British politics in controversial political circles.
"Government of the people, by the people, for the people," said Abraham Lincoln famously at Gettysburg. Those were not his words. Those were the words of that greatest of Englishmen, John Wycliffe, translator of the Bible. Wycliffe's words were a precursor to an extraordinary transformation, change in technology that redefined the relationship between the governing and the governed. So too in our own time. Whether you sit astride a mass of power in Westminster or in banking, in Whitehall or in Brussels, Wycliffe's words will become ever more insistent.
Unbeknownst to most people, the final and intense battle on earth will be over being obedient to the word of God or to the word of man. The choice is yours. So as I always encourage you, please study, research, investigate. That is the only way you'll have a clear understanding of events which are taking place in the world and in line with Bible prophecy. Until then, be prepared for the last study of the two kingdoms.